Welcome back to the Pittsburgh Free Will Baptist Women of Purpose Bible Study class. I'm so glad you're here. Today's study is going to be on Psalm 84. Let's look at its subtitles. In the New King James Version I'm reading, in regards to this chapter, it's called The Blessedness of Dwelling in the House of the Lord. That's a long subtitle, so let's shorten it to It's So Great to Be in God's House. It's written to the chief musician, or the worship leader in the temple or tabernacle. The instructions say in the subtitle that it's to be played on an instrument of gath called a giddith. From what I've found out, the giddith is a stringed instrument that the people of Gath used to play on to accompany and entertain themselves while they treaded grapes in the wine vats. You've heard of the land of Gath. That's the land of giants. It's where Goliath came from. David had spent time in Gath, and you can read about that in 2 Samuel 6 and 15. So he would have become acquainted with an instrument like this, maybe brought one back to Jerusalem for him to use or to introduce to the musicians in the choir. This psalm has David overtones, but it is not specifically assigned to David as the author. Why was the psalm written? Well, the author of Psalm 84 was deprived of his privilege of getting to worship in the house of the Lord. Doesn't say in here whether he was exiled, doesn't say if he was sick, distance was a problem maybe. It doesn't say if he was imprisoned or if he was traveling someplace, but as for him, he could not get to the Lord's house. How appropriate for us right now. The author, though unknown, tells us a few things about himself. He had experience in God's presence. He was currently missing out on the corporate worship that was apparently a common thing for him. He was determined to get back to church as soon as he could. And he was someplace he wasn't wanting to be. We don't know if that's physically. He was maybe miles away. We don't know if mentally he was in an unsettled or an unpeaceful state of mind. Or spiritually, maybe he was in need of a fill-up. I think we've all been there. Maybe this week will speak to you like it has to me. Let's pray. God, it's so good of you to provide your word to us. You're so merciful and gracious to open it up to us all these times before like a treasure chest. And I'm going to be bold enough to ask that you'll do it again today. Guide me and lead me. Be glorified in the words spoken. Amen. Okay, I'm reading from the New King James Version today, but whatever version you have will work just fine. Just follow along. So open your Bible. Grab a pen and a journal, maybe, or a notebook. Use your eyes as you watch me. Use your ears as you listen for God to speak. Use your hands to hold your Bible. Use your tactile senses to hold your Bible, or hold that pen, or make notes in your journal. And I ask that you let him speak to your heart as we look into Psalm 84. Psalm 84, verses 1 through 2. How lovely is your tabernacle, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and flesh cry out for the living God. These first two verses tell us a lot. First off, do you know what makes something lovely? It means it's loved. And that's all it says here. The author's house of worship is dearly loved. He has an intense desire to be there, no matter why he isn't. And it didn't matter to him which part of the church he was in. It states his true reason for wanting to be in the church, which is the living God, and he longed for fellowship with God and his church family. No part of him saw church attendance as an obligation. These verses are a challenge to our churches today. We need to offer more than programs, social connections, entertainment, excitement, or self-improvement. We must make them a place and a meeting place for God's people to meet the living God. Charles Spurgeon says this about these verses. There was no superstition in his love. The author loved the house of God because he loved the God of the house. His heart and flesh cried out, not for the altar and the candlestick, but for his God. We're going to watch as this psalmist used his pain to push him into a pilgrimage to get to the house of God. He didn't give up. He didn't give in. He made his heartache work for him. All right, let's look at verse 3. Psalm 84, verse 3. Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young, even your altars, O Lord of hosts, my God and my King. Sparrows and swallows are small, bold, tenacious nest builders. They look carefully, they choose wisely the porch corners, the eaves of the house, the barn lofts, the wreaths hanging from the front of your door sometimes. They build nests where it's safe, where it's high, and sometimes where they have the best vantage point. And honestly, sometimes in some of the most oddly weird places. I'm not sure if the author witnessed sparrows flitting around the actual tabernacle, or maybe he noticed one flying by him on his journey, but either way, he was envious of the birds. He was envious that they were not held back by any boundaries. They could come and go as they wanted. It doesn't say in verse 3 that the sanctuary or the altars are where she laid her egg, but it says where she laid her young. She intended to make it a home for her children, not just an incubator. It reminds me of the comfort found in Matthew chapter 10, verses 31 through 32. Let's read it. Not even a sparrow, worth only half a penny, can fall to the ground without your Father knowing it. And the very hairs on your head are numbered. So don't be afraid. You are more valuable to Him than a whole flock of sparrows. Valuable enough to have a safe home. Do you have a church home? One that preaches and teaches Bible truths? One that loves you and prompts you to grow daily in your walk with God? You need one. There is one out there that needs you. Even if you've never set foot in a church, even if it's been years since you've been in a church, or if you've been hurt by a church, or if you believe that you would not be welcome if they knew even a small portion of your story, there is a church out there for you. Maybe you're waiting until you think you've cleaned up enough or straightened out enough to be worthy to attend. Drop all that stuff and come, just as you are. Come home to church, is what the psalmist is saying. Notice that the last line of verse 3 says, "My God and my King." That's a precious double possession of his closest friend. He's grabbed hold of God with both hands, and he's not going to let go. But our psalmist wasn't only jealous of the birds of the air, the ones that came and went. He was also jealous of the people that worked in the temple. Let's see in verse 4. Blessed are those who dwell in your house. They will still be praising you, Selah. Now our attention is turned to the church staff, to the ministers, to the religious workers. We've learned in the last few weeks as we've been studying the Psalms, these would have been the priests and the folks from the tribe of the Levites. In his mind, he saw that they had a life of never-ending praise. That's how it should be for any of us. As God's children, as God's servants, everything people see us doing, they should see us doing with excitement, with love, with joy, and with excellence. In our commitments, whether it be talking to a video camera, cleaning the church restroom, sending out the church prayer chains, preaching behind the pulpit, pressing the button that brings up the house lights or bring down the house lights, mowing the churchyard, answering the church phone, wrangling kids in the nursery, being on a prayer team, whether it's at our workplace or at our homes, we have opportunities for constant praise as His children. This is a reminder that we may be involved in something that others might currently not be in. Maybe they're too sick to do what they once did. Maybe they're in a season of busyness right now to where they're raising littles that are going to soon and quickly, too quickly, grow up. Maybe God has you or someone you know in a place of pruning or stretching or seeking or just trusting while you wait for Him to do a work. The author ends with the word Selah, which means that's a lot to stop and think about. Let's look at verse 5. Verse 5 says, "Blessed is the man whose strength is in you, whose heart is set on a pilgrimage." Let's read it in the New Living Translation. "What joy for those whose strength comes from the Lord, who have their mind set on a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. Blessed is the one who has their strength in you. Blessed is the one that knows that nothing they can do, nothing the world offers, is the strength that they need. In this world, his strength and his treasure are not here, but it's to come. The strength is displayed by the love he has for God's house, for gathering with God's people. He's gaining this strength from walking or worshiping with other pilgrims. And his love and longing for the house of God aren't meant as an escape from the world, but as preparation for living in the world." And we must remember that. Our pilgrim knows he's just passing through this world, but realizes that he needs to get to the final destination. Here's a fact. Joy always comes to the child of God. Whether it's precariously in this life or unshakably in the next, it's going to get better. Let's read Psalm 84, verse 6. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a spring. The rain also covers it with pools. They refers to the pilgrims on their way to God's house, doing what he's asked them to do. Three times each year, every male over the age of 12 was required to attend services in Jerusalem. That meant traveling and the inconveniences of traveling at that day and time. That meant rough terrain. It meant scary journeys, sometimes leaving family behind in order to make this pilgrimage. It also required effort and expense. The Valley of Baca translates into the Valley of Weeping or the Valley of Aridness, less than pleasurable scenery, we might say. But the ones doing the traveling for the right reason pressed on. They built springs where they found bubbling up areas, and they celebrated when the raindrops fell and watered the parched ground. Satan wants us to believe that going to church, opening up our Bible, and living for God is an inconvenience and just one more thing added to our list. Here's the truth. I tell it to my Sunday school girls all the time. The truth is, Satan is a liar. These things will only help us. We have the opportunity to make the most of our traveling through this world. On our journey to heaven, we can set up those springs, dig those wells, build those areas of refreshments for ourselves and for the ones who follow us. Others did it for us. Here's a funny story. A man decided to journey through the desert on his own. He had read, he had planned, he had purchased all he needed for the trip. A few days into this trip, he had exhausted all his resources and was left crawling through the arid sand dunes in search of water. He needed nothing more than water. He came upon a group of Bedouins. "Water," he cried out through parched lips. "I need water." The head Bedouin said, "I can sell you a tie." "A tie?" he gasped. "I don't need a tie. I need water. I've got to have water to live." They kept saying, "We can sell you a tie." The man continued on. He came upon another group of Bedouins, and he asked them for the same request. "Water, please, I need some water." "I can sell you a tie," was their reply. The man shook his head and continued on into the desert landscape, knowing he was probably soon going to die. But he saw what he thought was a mirage. It had to be a mirage. There amidst the sand dunes, he saw what looked to be a posh country club in the middle of the desert. He approached the door, swung open the door, and approached the front counter, a bar of sorts, and said to the waiter, "Water, I need water." The attendant curtly and specifically said, "Sir, I can't serve you without a tie." Here it is. That's why we need to be listening to those who've maybe walked our paths before. Those who've gone before us are setting us up for success if we'll listen to them, is what it talks about in verse 84, or verse 6 of chapter 84. Let's read verse 7. They go from strength to strength. Each one appears before God in Zion. On a normal journey, especially a difficult one, the usual pattern is to go from strength to weakness or fatigue. Not so for those whose strength is in the Lord. They go from strength to strength. They gather strength from traveling together. Their resource is that they're never alone. But grab your Bible and look closely because the words change. They go is in plural. They cheer each other. They encourage each other. They lean on each other when it's hard. A quote says, "If you want to get warm, you must stand near the fire. If you want to get wet, you must get into the water. If you want joy, power, peace, eternal life, you must get close to or even into the one that has them." Together, they built spiritual muscles as they traveled. But then it changes. Each one, it says, appears before God. That's singular. That's individual. When we stand before God, we'll have no personal references, no character witnesses, no one to vouch for us. So while we're on this journey to godliness, let's travel as far together as he wants us to go. Let's grow as much as he wants us to grow together. Let's learn as much as he has for us to learn together. Let's go as hard and as deep and as long as he wants us to go together, so that when we stand alone before God, we'll have been led, pushed, pulled, and prayed there by God's grace and godly people. Let's look at verse 8. "O Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob, Selah." The psalmist is addressing the God of all power, the commander of hosts of heavenly armies. If I were to put it in my own words, here's what it would say. "God over all, I want to be in your house so bad I can't stand it. But I know that right where I'm at, right here and right now, you hear me. The devout of the day prayed three times a day, noon, 9 o'clock in the morning, noon, and 3 o'clock. It was believed that the most effective prayers were those offered in the temple. I get that. Praying in church is very great. Time spent at the altar is life-changing. Worship music leads us into his presence, and the preaching reminds us of our needs, our sins, and our hopes. But friends, God's not limited to a building. We've got to remember that. The psalmist knew that, and he turned this pilgrimage to Jerusalem into a prayer walk. Notice here he also mentions Jacob. Jacob is the one that wrestled with an angel for one of God's blessings. We can find his account in Genesis 32. Jacob was a determined prayer. He was a believing prayer. He was a trusting prayer. And in the end, you can see that he was a rewarded prayer. The psalmist again ends our verse with the word Selah. Another thought to stop and ponder, to let sink in, to allow to touch every bit of our life. Let's look at verse 9. O God, behold our shield and look upon the face of your anointed. This portion of the chapter leads me to believe it was not written by David, but maybe one of his servants. David was the protector of the Israelite people, and David was God's anointed king. In the middle of this writer's hard, sad, depressed time, because he was away from the worship of and corporate worship of his friends and his church, he was asking God to bless another. Let's read it in the New Living Translation. It says, O Lord, O God, look with favor upon the king, our shield. Show favor to the one you have anointed. Praying for others in some ways alleviates our own pain. Praying places us on the right highway, the highway to godliness, the highway from Baca to Zion. Praying puts us in God's presence, and praying readjusts our focus. And sometimes that's all we need. Verse 10 says, For a day in your courts is better than 1,000. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness. Did a song come to mind? I've been humming it all week as I've been studying this. Courts are the various rooms or areas of the temple or tabernacle complex. The writer knew nothing was more profitable in his life than being in God's house, even to be a doorkeeper, to watch people come and go into the sanctuary, to see people go in with burdens and out with freedom, to see sicknesses laid down, eternal life picked up, to maybe never get close enough to hear the music or hear the sermon, to maybe always be in the kids' class or in the nursery, just to be in God's house doing what God had asked him to do. He was content to do that. Paul puts it this way in Philippians chapter 3. For I was circumcised when I was 8 days old, having been born into a pure-blooded Jewish family that is a branch of the tribe of Benjamin. So I'm a real Jew, if ever there was one. What's more, I was a member of the Pharisees who demand the strictest obedience to the Jewish law, and zealous. Yes, in fact, I harshly persecuted the church and obeyed the Jewish law so carefully that I was never accused of any fault. I once thought these things were very important, but now I consider them worthless because of what Christ has done. Yes, everything else is worthless when compared with the priceless gain of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. In other words, the psalmist was willing to trade in everything the world could possibly offer for a doorkeeper's smock. He was willing to be the first one in the doorway and the last one out. Let's look at verse 11. For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from those who walk uprightly. Here's a quote. A sun for happy days and a shield for dangerous ones. A sun above, a shield around. A light to show the way and a shield to ward off any perils. Sun offers light, warmth, and beauty. That's God. A shield offers grace now and glory later. That's God too. Walking uprightly, as it refers in verse 11, means not bowed in shame. It means not bent over with worries or doubts or fears that we're not intended to carry. And it means walking around with our chin held high because of whose we are. Let's look at verse 12. O Lord of hosts, blessed is the man who trusts in you. Let's look quickly at the end of this verse. A little backwards, I know, but if you look at the very end of the verse, it ends with an exclamation point. It is showing belief, certainty, intensity, hope, and excitement. Blessed means to have joy, which is greater to be had than happiness. It happens when we believe God is who he says he is. We confide in him for all we do not know or do not understand. Happiness and joy comes when we lean on his strength, when we rely on his mercy, grace, and faithfulness, when we live like who he says we are, and when we bank on his promises, very much worth putting an exclamation mark on. Let's pray. God, I ask that you stir up in us a desire to be in your presence, whether it's in our homes, and even more so when we can finally get together again in worship. Help us recognize and push aside the obstacles and excuses keeping us from your house. Let us enjoy every step of the journey that leads us closer to you, good times and tough times, Baca valleys and Zion hills. Let us see every blessing you shower upon us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for joining us for the Women of Purpose Bible Study. I ask for next week that you look over Psalm 91 and join us again. Thank you.